The following podcast is created and sponsored by High Beam Ministry.
Nobody knows the trouble I see.
Suffering is a part of God's plan.
A child knows that. If we take happiness from God's hand, must we not take sorrow too?
Genuine faith in God is not increased by Bible study. It's not increased by knowledge or going to school to learn about anything, but true faith in God is increased when your faith is tested by trials and persecution.
Never give up. Never surrender.
Houston, we have a problem.
Welcome to the Ersatz Coffee Shop. This is Jay, your Truth Barista, and I'm serving up a steamy cup of God's truth for the average Joe. You can catch me and this podcast on my websites, truthbarista.com, all one word, truthbarista.com, and highbeamministry.com. That's HIGHBEAM ministry.com, as in car high beam. We're shining the light of God's truth on the road ahead.
Boy, I tell you, Truth Barista, it is really, I have had such a lousy morning. I don't understand these mornings.
It's been crazy. I mean, not only did the dishes break back there, but I burned my hand on the espresso machine. Why do these things always have to happen to me during the rush? It's crazy.
I don't know. These trials sometimes are a little bit too much, if you ask me.
Well, I know. Well, and then just the stuff that's going on in your life that you were telling me about.
Exactly.
But you know something? I found some stuff in the scriptures that are really good. I think we should talk about it today, the joy of trials. There's a joy in trials. Isn't that a masochistic thing?
It is, but you know, I just saw somebody walk in, one of our faithful patrons, that he was telling me a story the other day that kind of fits into trials, because what he went through and what happened to him really ended up to be fantastic.
You're talking Dave, right?
Yeah, Dave.
Right? Okay, well, let's go over and talk to him. Okay, grab a cup of coffee. Got
all
mine
right
here. Okay. Hey, Dave, how's it going?
Hey, Jay. Doing well, thank you.
Good, good, good. Amazing Larry here tells me that you've been through a particular experience. We're talking about trials today, and he said you've been through a really difficult time or some sort of a trial that's really kind of affected you. Tell me about it.
Well, Jay, you know, sometimes you've been in the workplace and you've known when people just haven't quite fit into that culture.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I found myself on the opposite side of that equation once, and I was the person that wasn't quite fitting in.
Okay, so give me the background.
Here's the deal. I thought I was doing pretty good in the workplace. I was really enjoying it and doing well, but my boss didn't quite think that I was doing quite as well as what I thought I was doing that way.
Oh, kind of sounds like around here, doesn't it, Larry?
Yes,
just saying.
It does.
Okay.
Well, you know, the interesting part on that, because I had my plans, and I thought, you know, this is where God has me, this is where my ministry is at, and it became very obvious through my boss that, no, that wasn't exactly the place that God wanted me to be after all. And that was pretty hard for my ego, that was pretty hard for me just to kind of struggle through that idea that I thought I was doing really good, but clearly my boss didn't think I was doing so good.
Okay, so what kind of pressure did that put on you?
Well, you know, that whole idea of, especially for guys, you know, a lot of our self-worth is tied up in what we do.
Oh, yeah.
And in the workplace, that's a big thing. That's our identity. And to all of a sudden to have that kind of coming around me and realizing, oh, I'm not doing so good after all, made me really question, okay, who am I? What am I really doing here? Is this what God would have for me or not? And so I had to go through a lot of that reflection and introspection that, yeah, to be honest with you, is pretty painful at times.
So a trial on your work was actually a trial on you. It was a difficulty that you took to heart.
And isn't that how God oftentimes works, right? I mean, we find ourselves in difficult situations, and sometimes we want to just run from it and avoid it, but yet God might have something else going on inside.
You know, you want to sit in with us, because I've got this great verse, and I like to do word studies here, and we came up with this verse that we had talked about a while back this week. This is the verse. It comes from James 1, 2 through 4. It says, "Consider it great joy, my brothers, whenever you experience various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. But we don't stop there. Verse 4. But endurance must do its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. So if we go through some of these words, you can let us know how this tied into your experience, okay? Okay, so I've got my list of words here that I was going to share with Amazing Larry. So the first thing is consider it great joy, my brothers, whenever you experience or encounter various trials. That word there means to fall into or to be encompassed. And the thing is like most trials you can't avoid. God allows things to come into your life and they encompass you, and there is no way over them, under them, or around them. The only thing you can go is through them. So that's what that word means. It's to be surrounded, facing overwhelming odds, and you know that a fight is coming.
And we're supposed to be joyful at that time?
Well, it's not about that. Experiences like this are not enjoyable, but there's a joy on the other side. That's what is being written here by James, okay? And the trials. What's a trial? A trial is an experiment. It means approving the sense of something allowed for a purpose. Now, you and I were talking about this, Amazing Larry, how nowadays we have helicopter parents.
Yeah, risk-free societies.
Exactly. People go to great lengths to avoid people experiencing bad times. Now, bad times, it could hurt you, you know, could destroy your self-esteem, you know, that kind of stuff. But look at this. Compare today's snowflake culture in colleges, where you can hear one word that triggers you and you'll have to run for a safe space. But then you go back to World War II and you see 18-year-olds coming off of a boat on D-Day facing German gunfire. Okay, what's the difference between those two 18-year-olds?
Mommy, where are you? I'm scared. Mommy!
They're moving into an environment that has risk versus no risk. The no-risk people haven't been prepared to face that. And yet you've got people who are going into World War II who have already gone through the Depression as children. And so they've got this reservoir of courage built up in them. You're not getting that if you don't go through trials.
But the risk that you're talking about, David, had to do with an unknown. Where am I going to go? What am I going to do? So,
and yet still trying to be confident that God called me to work and to be use that as a ministry.
And yet, you did end up taking a risk. And what happened at the end of that risk?
Well, through that whole process, I'm forced to start looking for other employment, and incredible opportunities open up that I could have never imagined. And to understand that I had built my plan on where I thought I was going to go and where I want to be, yet God had directed a completely different place to move overseas and to do a ministry overseas was just absolutely incredible. Something I could have never fathomed through it.
If you'd have stayed in that position, you would never would have gotten the personal experience, the growth inside of you, or the opportunities that he had for you.
Absolutely. Or experiencing what his plan was for me for that season of life.
But mm-hmm. You also told me that even now, you're going overseas all the time on short-term missions trips because you took a risk at one point in going overseas and working and whatever, and got accustomed to other cultures.
Oh, and really what that is, that planted a seed in our hearts to say, have a love for other cultures. And as you said, Larry, ever since then, been doing short-term mission trips, leading trips overseas to experience other cultures and trying to share with other people in my family and in my neighborhood that might be able to learn from those other experiences as well.
So let me ask you a question. In that trial that you experienced, did you find that that particular challenge in that workplace actually developed an endurance or a perseverance that you've drawn on in future trials that have come up and faced you, especially in the mission field?
Well, you know, the first time you face any kind of trial, you're caught off guard because you don't know what to expect. And then it seems like once you have one experience, that next experience isn't quite so shocking anymore.
Or if you're facing the unknown, it's very scary the first time you face the unknown. The second time you face the unknown, you can say, I don't know what's coming, but I've been here before. So, you know, God's always there somewhere.
And he's always been faithful. So if he's been faithful in the past, he'll be faithful in the future.
And that faithfulness was seen through an Old Testament guy by the name of Job, right?
Yeah, you want to talk about the poster child for trials and tribulations?
I mean, it was a showpiece.
And that's a great word for it, because when you look at Job and what he went through, there was no personal benefit for him. God was challenged by Satan, and Satan means adversary in Hebrew. So his adversary came to him and he said, yeah, Job just follows you because he's got life good. And God goes, okay, fine, I will let you take it all from him. And I'll let you take him down to the very lowest level through all these trials and tribulations, and he will show you what he's made of. And that's exactly what a trial is. A trial, actually, the word for trial is an experiment, a proving, which means It's like trying to find out if gold or diamonds are pure. You have to send them through what they call assaying. It's a test, and to find out if gold is pure, you know what you use to find out? You use acid on it. You put acid.
Hmm.
So, first of all, if you want to find out if diamonds or gold are pure, you just have to send them through a horrific circumstance. Well, we don't like that, but mm-hmm. it has the same effect of proving who we are inside. That's a trial and a test.
You know, when I go through a test, one of the things that I have learned is that I don't always believe what I say I believe. That's what a test does. You say you believe in healing. Well, how much of healing do I really believe in? You know what I'm saying?
Until you're faced with that.
Until you're faced with it.
Well, I used to say, you know, if you want to find out what's in the garbage can, you have to shake the garbage can. And that's what a trial and a tribulation does. It gets into your life, and God allows it in many times, and he starts shaking your life. And what comes to the surface is what's inside of you. And it could be anger, frustration, or it could be peace and love. It's what's in there. And God knows how to tailor circumstances to what he needs from you. Does that speak to any of what you've been through or what you're facing today, David?
Oh, does it ever. And here's the deal. When you experience something like that, you have the ability to look back and see how God has been faithful in the past, to say, when I face perhaps a different kind of trial in the workplace or some other kind of bad day that's going on, I know that God has been faithful in the past, he'll be faithful in the future, and that he wants to do a bigger work in me.
Now, I need to clarify something in my study here, that not every trial is specifically sent by God to try us, but every trial, whether it's a difficulty or it's a temptation, does prove our trust, our loyalty, and our commitment to God. And that brings us actually to the second part of the verse, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And that testing right there is that word for to send something through to prove what it actually is, if it's genuine, if it's real, or if it's authentic, not fake or pretending. And by the way, God continually allows trials in our life to test what? Our faith. Now, our faith is not a mental thing. It's a trust. It's a heart trust. God goes, basically, in every trial, God could be saying, you can hear the words in the background, do you really trust me? Do you trust me? How many times of us as dads have looked at our kids and our kids go, I can't ride that bike. And you plop them on the seat and you go, trust me. You can just, Dad, I can't walk through that dark alley. It's too scary. Trust me. Why? I'm with you.
And sometimes God sends a whale.
That's true.
You know, I mean, there's just one.
Who are you
those,
talking about?
One of those whales that come along, and boy, I'll tell you, poor Jonah sitting around sloshing around going, what in the world did I do wrong?
Well, and think of this too. We always think of Jonah on the backside of this after he's been burped up on the shore, but imagine being swallowed and that's the end. In your mind, I'm done. I've entered the trial and death is on the other side. And he's not just there for one day. He's there for 3 days and he's in the dark so he can't track the passage of time. And not only that, he's being burned by gastric juices.
And stinks. It stinks.
Right. And the air quality, I'm sure, was wonderful in this belly, right? So he's going through this unknown trial in these horrible conditions. And once again, it's the acid test. And he comes out the other side. And I once heard Winky Pratney, a preacher, talk about how he comes out and his hair's probably all frizzed out and his skin is bleached white from, and he walks up to Nineveh and goes, repent. And of course they repented. Look what they were facing.
Right.
Scary. But he made it through the other side, and that was the testing of his faith, and he hung in there with God. And here's the important part, knowing. The word knowing here isn't intellectual knowing. See, if we come to a trial with an intellectual trust in God, we'll often collapse and collapse fast. But this word knowing is an experiential knowing. There is a purpose behind the trial to build an experience in us so that we can continue to walk with God more trustingly into the future.
And your experience, David, in all of this, what was the takeaway?
The takeaway, I think, for me was my identity is not in what I do. My identity is in Christ. And that idea of I make my plans, but I need to be able to yield them at any point in time to what God might have. And mm-hmm. he might not necessarily show me in the way that I want him to show me.
Exactly.
But might send a whale my way to take me someplace else.
Uh-huh. In fact, it reminds me of this old Yiddish proverb that I always crack up when I hear. It's like, if you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans.
Mm-hmm. That's good. That's good. But experience is one of those things that helps us to endure. And what are we enduring for, Truth Barista? Barista? Is it to just see how much we can endure, or is there something being developed in us?
Right here it says, knowing that the testing of your faith produces.
Mm-hmm.
That means God has an end result in mind when he allows you to go through a trial, or if he brings a trial to you. There he is working toward a goal. And what is that goal? Endurance. And it doesn't stop there. Endurance is this ability to remain steadfast and constant, but the question is, in what? And that produces this next part, which is endurance must have its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. So here's the end goal of all of this testing and trial. It's to produce an endurance so that you can be teleos. Isn't that a great word? That is a Greek word that means complete or full or to its greatest measure. So when it says that Jesus is the end of the law, it doesn't mean he did away with the law. It simply means in Jesus, he is the fullest expression of God's law in a human form.
Now, that endurance is supposed to make us complete. I get that, but complete in character, the character of mankind, the character of just good principles or values, or the character of Christ.
What does the Bible say? It says that we are being formed into the image of Messiah, of Jesus. That's God's purpose, is as we go through the trial and build endurance and stay faithful in trust, these things are forming us into his son's image. That's the end goal. He wants to see a lot of little Jesuses walking around, right? We're being formed into his image.
Well, in your experience, David, you and I had a conversation one of the days when you came in for a cup of coffee. You talked about in the marketplace, you've developed your skills, but it isn't just skills, it's the character behind those skills that really produces the endurance of making those skills known to, well, a broader group of people, be more fair. And why don't you speak to that?
You know, and isn't that the case? That's what God wants within us. He wants to develop that character, that perseverance, that endurance, Truth Barista, that you were talking about. Sometimes we train ourselves up with certain kinds of skills that are marketable in the workplace, and they might make room for us to build a career. And yet it's the character behind those skills that seems like God is most interested in all the time.
Mm-hmm. In fact, that's what we just went through. We had some Bible studies that we did a couple of months ago talking about the fruit of the Spirit. And all the fruit of the Spirit are various character traits of Jesus: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness. And I lost one. Self-control. I'm missing one because I know there are nine there. But the point is that all of these things are character traits that God is building in us. So, for example, we get sent through a trial of having to work with somebody who's rather unlovable. And so, face it, we are in no position to transfer. We are in no position to fire them. There is no way we can avoid them because they happen to be sitting into the cube right next to us. So guess what? God goes, now I want you to grow to be more loving.
You know, Truth Barista, I just love what we're talking about right now. But you know, right now we've got some trials coming in the door. They're called customers.
Okay, I'll get back. Hey, hang tight, Dave. I'll bring you a cup of coffee. We'll be right back. Hold on.
Oh my gosh, this Truth Barista is really great. I have learned so much from him, so I have been inviting more of my friends to join me in coming here to the coffee shop.
Hey, my name's Lindsay, and I come to the coffee shop every day for a good cup of coffee. And on some days when I get here, there's a great Bible study going on with the Truth Barista. It is so good that as I listen to what's being talked about, I even have to order another cup of coffee or two. There are so few places today where you can actually get a good conversation about God and His Word, but you can right here with the Truth Barista. Every week we hear truth being talked about, and it is as rich as their coffee. There are two things I'd like you to do. First, let people know how good the conversations are here with the Truth Barista. And then second, could you help out with a monetary tip to help this kind of communication stay on the internet each week? I talked with the Truth Barista, and we're being heard in the Far East, the Middle East, and all around North America. So this is a solid investment of your charitable dollars. The place where you can donate securely is thetruthbarista.com. Thanks for your help in helping us tell people about the truth in Jesus Christ.
You know, some of those lunch rushes, man, those get kind of harrowing after a while. Oh my gosh, I never made so many sandwiches in my life. Oh, okay, hi Dave, we're back again. Here's your coffee. It was exactly what you wanted, right?
Exactly. I was trying to figure out, you talked about Talios and being full, but my cup was getting quite empty there.
Exactly, so I have Talios to your cup. It is full and complete, lacking nothing. But that brings us back to the last part of this verse here, where it says, endurance must do its complete work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. God wants our faith and our trust in Him to be full and complete and lacking nothing, which means when we face a trial or a tribulation that comes our way, it doesn't shake us, it doesn't rattle us, it doesn't push us off base. In fact, there's one guy in the Bible, he's a real minor character, but he is an amazing guy. His name was Eleazar. He was one of David's mighty men. Speaking of David,
I like that name. We could call him Eleazar.
That's right. King David had a group of three warriors that were specifically assigned to him. They were called David's mighty men, and one of these guys is Eleazar. Well, at some point, Eleazar is surrounded by a bunch of Philistines, and so he pulls his sword, and he defends this plot of ground, and it's funny, because it's a bean field. It says it's a lentil field. I'm going to defend the vegetable patch! So he's sitting, and these Philistines are coming at him, and he's swinging away, and he is fighting so hard and so long that the tendons in his hand freeze up, and he says it grips his sword and he couldn't let it go. In fact, his hand froze to the sword. And I thought, what a perfect picture that in life we've got trials and tribulations that come at us like these Philistines, and they're attacking us from all sides, and there is no way except fighting through it. He fights so hard, so long, that his hand cleaves to his sword. Our hands must cleave to God and to His Word. That is the only way we're going to be able to fight our way through a trial and a tribulation. And he actually is commended for that particular thing that happened to him. In fact, his name, which I find interesting, is El Azar in Hebrew. El is God. Azar means strength. God is my strength. What a great picture for what we're talking about today. And that's what God is trying to build into us. He showed His endurance, and it produced the desired effect of a maturity, a strength of character, and a perseverance that fought through the trial, and he came out victorious on the other side. That's what God is trying to build in us.
So what would you say, David, Eleazar, what would you say to our listeners today about trials? Based on just your testimony and your story today.
Whether it be a Philistine coming at you, whether it be a boss or a coworker or a struggle at work, whatever your hand finds to do, whether it's a sword in your hand fighting off the Philistines or whatever, do it all for the glory of God.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Amazing, Larry. What'd you get from this?
Well, I just think that trials build the kind of character that we're looking for. You know, I think about dieting or strength building. It is not pleasant to go to the gym every day.
No.
But at the end of the day or the end of a week or a month, and you see your body is stronger, mm-hmm. and your clothes fit better, all of those things, there is a benefit to those mornings you just don't want to get out of bed to go exercise.
And that reminds me, getting back to what we talked about, you know, some of the snowflake generation that we're in right now. How do you immunize a body? You introduce something that the body recognizes as a threat, and then the body builds up an immunity against it, a strength against it. If you look at strength training, what are you doing? You are challenging your muscles with increasing weights, and in the long run, it's not enjoyable doing it, but you have great joy when you look at the mirror and you go, I am so mighty and strong. I am going to pummel you. And that's the joy that you get in the result that's on the other side. God is doing strength training in us in the same way. He's immunizing us through these trials to withstand temptations and course of life in order to bring forth the image of Jesus in us. That's really God's end goal for every Christian, that we may be mature in Him and complete in Him and lacking nothing in it. Why? Because it's to the praise of His glory and His glory alone.
You know, Truth Barista, it's been a delight knowing that you can do an impression of Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Arnold Schwarzenegger, yeah.
And look at the kind of patrons we have coming into the Arizat Coffee House. I mean, David, I mean, this is great. This is kind of a good example of some of them. them. Not all of them, but this is a top-notch kind of patron we've got coming.
Arnold Schwarzenegger?
No.
Well, you look kind of like him. That's quite amazing there. Hey, do you want to lead us in prayer regarding this subject and the folks that are here in the Erzatz Coffee Shop?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. So, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for the work that you're doing in the hearts of all of us. Thank you for the vision that you have for each one of us. And, Lord, would you strengthen us that we could handle accurately your word, that we'd be able to accomplish your purposes, and we'd be able to experience you in every aspect of our life, whether through trials, through temptations, through good times. Lord, you are present, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Dave. Hey, by the way, I got to get back to work. And you, sir,
yes, sir.
You, sir, have to go back and do those dishes. I will be up front. You take care of the back. And Dave, thanks for coming
back to work. Thanks.
This is Jay, the Truth Barista. I'd love to hear from you. Do you have suggestions? Do you have comments? Would you like to support us? We'd like all that. To do so by email, contact me at thetruthbarista@gmail.com. That's thetruthbarista@gmail.com.
Happy trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then.
Making excuses is a bad habit we all practice. It would be better for all of us if we practiced a no-excuse zone in our daily lives. It's easier to make excuses than it is to make things right. God makes no excuses when he says, "He will never leave you nor forsake you." He's always just a prayer away. Thanks for joining us.
This is Jay, your Truth Barista. Thanks for listening to the Truth Barista podcast. The best way to find out when a new podcast drops is through RSS feed. Go to our website, look for the RSS button, press it, and then enter your email. You'll be notified when a new podcast drops. Thanks for listening.